Welcome to Brian Lehrer Live, where web video meets the issues. Tonight, wither the economy, underline wither. I don't know about you, but when the foreclosure man comes knocking at my door, I want J.P. Morgan to bail me out, don't you? Also, our new governor got us thinking, no, not about that, about new high-tech gadgets for the blind. And finally, Tibet rises up, China cracks down. This is not the Olympic preview Beijing was hoping for.
Cars burned, shops were looted, and crowds of ethnic Tibetans clashed with police and soldiers. The independence protests were the fiercest in the region in two decades.
First, here are this week's online video picks. Number one, after all the debate about Barack Obama's pastor and his YouTube clips, there is now some video of another radical reverend. Rod Parsley has endorsed John McCain. McCain just met him recently, but has called him a spiritual guide. Parsley has written that Islam is a religion based on deception, that Muhammad received revelations from demons, not the true God, and here's his take on Planned Parenthood.
You know, if I were to call for the sterilization or elimination of an entire segment of society, I'd be labeled a racist or a murderer or, at very best, a Nazi. Yet every single year, millions of our tax dollars are funding a national organization built upon that very goal. Their target? African Americans. That's right. The death toll? Nearly 1,500 African Americans a day. The shocking truth of black genocide is next on Breakthrough. Right now, our own government is allowing organizations like Planned Parenthood to legally take the innocent lives of precious baby girls and baby boys, and even footing the bill for it all with our tax dollars, turning every single one of us into accessories to murder. That's right, your taxes murdering innocent children.
Remember, John McCain once called Jerry Falwell and Pat Robertson agents of intolerance, but more recently changed his mind on that. Now he calls that man a spiritual guide. So how exactly will he run against Obama's pastor right? We'll have to wait and see. Pick number two from the website Barely Political. Maybe the holiday this week reminded everyone, Obama may deny he's part of this group, but his name sure sounds like it.
Barack Obama.
We don't know who in the heck he is. Well, I'd like to know more about Obama.
Doesn't his name sound a little foreign? Obama, what is that? It sounds a little Irish. And in a time of war, can we really afford to trust our country to a leprechaun?
You know, I've always maintained that Obama is an Irish name. You just put the apostrophe after the O and we're all set.
The Obama campaign is fighting back now at the Clinton campaign, accusing them of fear-mongering. Here's what happened this morning. The Drudge Report posted this picture on its website. The Drudge Report claims this photo was circulated by the Clinton campaign.
A mountain of empty beer kegs, hundreds stacked outside this distributor of Senator beer. Locals say many of the kegs were leftovers from Obama victory celebrations.
The Illinois senator with Irish roots now has a realistic shot at getting to the White House.
Look out for his name. When all else fails, be afraid of his name.
And we are afraid, Michelle. Because if the phone rings in the White House at 3 a.m., do you really want a leprechaun answering the call?
Oh, and you know the former Israeli Prime Minister, Ehud Barak? Maybe Obama is really... But Obama doesn't look... Oh, you never know. Pick three. Imagine how our crazy system for choosing a president must look these days to people outside this country. Like the people from Australian TV who made this.
Well, as previously vouched... Safe unto you by Senor Yours Truly, the U.S. elections will dominate the media this year. And to help you make sense of it, our North American political correspondent, Wanda Nee Babcock, has put together this guide as to just how the electoral process works across the United States. Wanda.
Well, thank you, Sean. Well, to become a party's nominee for president, a candidate must win the support of the majority of delegates to that party's national convention. The delegates to the national convention vote for the nominee or candidate as determined by the outcomes of the state caucuses and primary elections. Now, the number of convention delegates who vote for these nominees or candidates is divided amongst the states proportionally. Now, most of these delegates are pledged to a candidate or nominee who wins the state's primary or caucus, but each party in each state has its own guidelines for awarding these delegates who vote for the nominee or candidate at the national convention. Now, some states divide their delegates proportionally. Some states select unpledged delegates who can vote for any candidate or nominee they like, regardless of the results of the primary or caucuses. Counting takes place to determine which Democrat candidate or nominees the first to secure 2,183 votes from 4,364 delegates pledged or unpledged at the national convention, and which Republican candidate or nominees the first to secure 1,191 delegates pledged or unpledged of the 2,380 elected to the national convention, before finally the candidate with most money is declared president.
Got that? Online video pick number four from filmmaker Lee Stranahan on YouTube. No fan of President Bush, let me tell you. He calls this Telecom Terror TV.
The world. It's a scary freaking place. But President Bush is standing firm on the most important issue to your security. Immunity for giant corporations who help the Bush administration violate the Constitution. It's so important, the president says he won't sign the FISA bill he needs to protect you until the corporations are protected first. Rest easy, America. This is a fight George Bush believes in. Because if you can sue a giant telecom company who violated your privacy rights, the terrorists win. This message paid for by Republicans trying to get you to crap your pants so you forget how we screwed everything up.
And video pick number five. Like your local cop on the beat? Give him a shout out on the website Rate My Cop. While the site caused quite a stir when it launched, here's an example of how some cops get positive street cred after a good rating.
Just make sure you keep the sidewalks clear if it starts getting pretty heavy around here. Enjoy your time protesting. You live in the United States, the greatest country in the world, and you have a great time. I just don't want you running out in the streets getting hit by a car, because then you wind up here at Kaiser Permanente or maybe at Children's Hospital. I don't want anything to happen to you.
That California cop got rated 5 stars. You can see why. The Rate My Cop site allows you to rate any police officer you come in contact with and includes the names and precincts of over 130,000 officers nationwide. Some police officers feel that this information puts them at increased risk of physical harm, but the site's owners claim that it is a resource to help the public interface with the people sworn to protect them. And that's our online video picks for this week. This is Brian Lehrer Live, where web video meets the issues. Now, this past Monday, New York's first African-American governor was sworn into office. And although he may not be America's first legally blind governor, that honor, according to the New York Times, belongs to 11 days in Arkansas history with a very short term of Bob Cowley Riley. But the occasion is no less important to New Yorkers. Let's take a look at how one New York organization is using technology to help the visually impaired. Here with us to discuss and to demonstrate is Dr. Bruce Rosenthal, low vision expert at Lighthouse International, serving blind people in New York on East 59th Street. Dr. Rosenthal, welcome to our show.
That's a pleasure to be here.
Now, for people who have been hearing about David Paterson, that he isn't blind, but he's legally blind, what's the difference?
Well, David Paterson is blind in his left eye. He has vision in his right eye, and the vision in his right eye is reported to be 2400. That is 20 times less than 20/20. Legal blindness is made of two parts. You're either legally blind according to your vision on the eye chart, and so when people are reading the eye chart, they are usually going down to the 20/20 line. The 2200 line is 10 times larger. So if you have 2200 in the better eye, you're considered legally blind if you're wearing the best correction, contact lenses or glasses. Part two has to do with your peripheral, your side vision. Normally, if you have two functioning eyes, you have peripheral vision of about 180 degrees. Bill Bradley was said to, when he played basketball, have 190 degrees. Mm. When you're legally blind in your better eye, and we're talking about the better eye, you have 20 degrees or less. So if your normal vision is 180 and you only have, let's say, 18, you have less than 1/9 of your normal peripheral vision. But there's really something else that goes into a definition, and I personally introduced with one of our researchers, Aris Arditi, at the Lighthouse, another part of the definition which we felt was very important. We were in Spain in 1996, and we talked about visual acuity, visual field, your peripheral vision, and we talked about something called contrast sensitivity. This is just actually a picture of a chart that was developed by Dr. Arditi. And what you have here are a series of letters that get lighter and lighter and lighter. So the letter in the upper left-hand corner is 100% contrast. With every vision problem, you get progressively less contrast. Now, how does that apply to everyday life? If you're sitting down trying to read a medicine bottle, for example, and you have an eye condition such as a cataract, you may not be able to see that medicine label because it's just too light. So contrast is never talked about. If you have very poor contrast and you try to, for example, walk into a theater, you'll have a problem. If you're sitting at a restaurant in New York and 8 o'clock they turn the lights down and everybody grabs for the candle, it's because the contrast is not good enough. So again, this really enters into vision loss.
Right, so that's not about size. A magnifying glass wouldn't help that.
Not at all.
That's about.
You need good lighting. Now let's talk a little about the governor's problem. Where does it fit on the spectrum of vision loss? At the Lighthouse, we really take care of individuals from infancy and children all the way up to people. This year we have somebody over 103. So it's really vision loss across the lifespan. And when we talk about vision loss, we're talking about best corrected vision with eyeglasses, medicine, or surgery.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
I was going to say, so if we start at this end of the spectrum, normal people bounce up at this line 20/20, let's say. 20/200 comes over here. Profound vision loss is over here. So the governor, theoretically, if you're in the legally blind range, you theoretically have very good usable vision all the way up to here. And even people who have profound vision loss, we have substitution methods to help them read again. For example, a computer, if you have a Microsoft or an Apple computer, you have an accessibility icon, and that's what we work at the Lighthouse, teaching individuals how to get into their computer and have the computer talk back to you. Because everything that you type into your computer, the computer will speak it back to you.
So you could type and have it, or you could read email that way. It will basically scan it.
You could have everything, including your email, read to you by your computer. Most people don't know that. There's another function inside your computer, a magnifier, which will go across the screen like a regular hand magnifier, and you could change the magnification on your screen.
Now, you talked about the contrast issue. You have a device here that helps people with contrast, don't you?
Yes, this actually is a portable closed-circuit television. The closed-circuit television, interestingly enough, goes back to 1968. And what's unique about this particular device is I can actually change the contrast from white, black letters on a white background to, in this case, maybe white letters on a black background or even different colors.
And so it's reading from that piece of paper that you have behind it, which is a printout of the article on the governor's blindness.
Exactly. And so you could use this if you're a college student. You could take it to the library, read any textbook that you want. The advantage of this particular device is that I can not only change the contrast, I can change magnification. And so, as I mentioned to you, contrast is something that most people don't even talk about. Your own eyeglasses that you perhaps are wearing may have on your lenses an anti-reflection coating. Well, they may help in a studio like this to cut out annoying reflections from the lights, but they actually increase light transmission through the lens about 8% to enhance the contrast. So everybody might have that put on their lens as well to reduce annoying reflections.
Interesting. The governor is very dependent on people reading to him, he tells me. And now I used to do this as a volunteer at the Lighthouse where you work. I would go to East 59th Street, and because one thing I can do well, there aren't that many things I can do well, one thing I can do well is read with a clear voice. So I figured that's a good kind of volunteer work for me to do. And mostly because I was a graduate student in science once upon a time, they had me reading to science graduate students and social science graduate students who needed graduate level textbooks read to them. But the governor is very dependent on people, aides on his staff and others, reading to him everything from the daily newspapers to bills that are introduced in the legislature to his everyday mail.
There are different ways that you can get that information, by the way. Let's take the governor. Let's suppose that he wanted to do this alone and he wasn't able to access these devices here easily. He can actually take a document and scan it into a computer, and it will read it back to him. There's actually another very interesting computer that, again, helps individuals at the lighthouse who have, let's say, different kinds of vision loss in which they've lost their peripheral vision. We could present reading material just the way you do on a teleprompter where it scrolls it up in high contrast. We could also present a continuous line across the screen, and I always think of the zipper going around on Times Square, or even one letter at a time.
Now, you've also got a special cell phone with you, don't you?
This cell phone has a high contrast screen so that the numbers and the letters will be much larger than a normal number or letter. And it has another special feature. This is called the jitterbug. You actually will hit the zero and you get a live operator, which is very unusual nowadays, and say, "Would you please dial my mother? Would you please dial my sister?" So again, I think this is one area that we're working on at the Lighthouse to make sure that individuals who have a vision loss can access a lot of technology, and it's not very easy, especially, for example, the iPod is something that we'd like to see much more accessible, but it's not.
Now, take me down that road. How could the iPod be more vision-impaired accessible?
Just so somebody can navigate, you know, get to different parts of the iPod, how do they know where one thing is if the contrast is not good?
Yes.
And we run into this problem, again, where contrast isn't very good, or there may be too much real estate on the screen, and somebody who has very poor visual acuity might not be able to see each individual section on the iPod.
So time produces different pieces of technology that can help people with different kinds of vision impairment. You've showed us a couple of things already, and I understand that the Lighthouse staff itself is working on a chip, an actual chip, a retinal chip that can be implanted in some people with the problem of pigmentosis.
We're actually involved with a patient. The patient will get a retinal chip implanted. There are different methods that are being worked on right now where they actually have either a retinal chip or they'll have a camera that goes into the back of the visual cortex of the brain. And these are for people who have no usable vision. And I think this is an incredibly fascinating and wonderful area. As they're able to put more information on a chip, you'll be able to, instead of just getting a few pixels, seeing somebody move. And by the way, if you have no usable vision, and I know that something's off to my right, that's very helpful in terms of mobility. And right now, what we do for mobility is take people out on the street at the Lighthouse and teach them how to travel around. But if you can do some of this by yourself, that's a phenomenal advance, and I see that coming.
How far away is it?
Estimations can be anywhere from, let's say, 10 to 20 years.
Oh, that long.
But I think with the way technology is going, I think it's really very hard to estimate. It might even be faster.
Now, we've been talking about some of the devices and some of the issues. Let's make it personal. Here is one woman's story of becoming legally blind in a video from the Lighthouse.
I became a loner, always hiding the problem, refusing to admit that I was handicapped.
It's very hard because a lot of times the patients or clients really feel it's like they've been given a death sentence. Victoria, when I first met her, she was really feeling very depressed, feeling that her life had stopped.
I met with Mrs. Chow every day. I had to go to class Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, for 2 weeks. We worked in the kitchen. We worked in doing ordinary daily tasks that people take for granted. At the lighthouse, the optometrist worked with me in trying to find some enlargement tool which could enable me to maximize whatever little vision I had left. One of the amazing benefits of the lighthouse to me has been the part of the program that has staff come to your home. I feel victorious with my new life. When I learned about 3 months ago that I lost additional vision, I did not panic. I don't know what can be done, but whatever can be done, the lighthouse will help me to do it. As long as there is some light coming through, I will see.
So what has David Patterson's ascension to the governorship meant to the blind or visually impaired community?
I think it means that there's no limit to what you can accomplish regardless of whether you're at the good end of the visual spectrum or at the profound vision loss end. He's really an example for everybody that you can achieve anything in life. It's just your attitude and perseverance.
You know, he started his inaugural address, you probably saw it, when they gave him the gavel, by telling a joke on himself about another time he was given a gavel, and because he was so visually impaired, he smacked the gavel right on a glass and smashed the glass. Who knows if the story is even true? But it was really a joke on his own blindness, and I have a feeling it wound up putting a lot of people around the state at ease with this particular disability and maybe made it more easy for them to talk about it, do you think?
I think it's changed the aspect of people going into jobs now where somebody would say, I don't want them working for me. They don't have the capability. We were going over a case today where we're helping somebody have a wonderful job. The person's visually impaired, blind in one eye as well, and we know this person can accomplish that job. And I think the reception from the corporations will be, let's have somebody on our staff who can do it. So, you know, I think We've seen people who brought to the forefront hearing loss and Betty Ford with breast cancer and, you know, drug problems. But here's vision. Vision has been something very few people talk about. And the one person who brought it to light was Henry Grunwald, who became editor-in-chief of Time and Life. And Henry had macular degeneration and wrote a book about that. But Henry was one of the few people that did that. And vision loss just doesn't seem to get on the radar screen, but it has this
and
week.
And now we have a poster child in the governor of New York. Thank you very much for joining
us. Thank you for having me.
This is Brian Lehrer Live, where web video meets the issues. This year's Summer Olympic Games in Beijing have already become a playing field for a long-simmering political dispute over Tibet. Tibet supporters the world over have seized this public spotlight to increase the pressure on China to grant Tibetans more independence over their region and their culture. Let's take a look at last weekend's report from AlJazeera.net on the protests in Tibet.
Heavy military presence on the streets of the Tibetan capital, Lhasa. Deserted streets, blocked roads and closed shops as a curfew remains in place following the deadly anti-China demonstrations that took place on Friday.
It's messy out there. Many Tibetans saw cars and destroyed them. They hit the people they saw. They hit the Chinese. They might be unhappy or unsatisfied with the government or something else.
Cars burned, shops were looted, and crowds of ethnic Tibetans clashed with police and soldiers. The independence protests were the fiercest in the region in two decades. The protests, which grew from peaceful demonstrations led by monks earlier in the week, had turned violent. These photos obtained by Al Jazeera were taken by tourists and show early incidents of the protests in Lhasa. And the government response was swift and harsh.
Fighting, looting, burning. These actions destroy the stability of society. These events can be described as an organized and planned plot. We are very determined to denounce this separatist activity, and the plot will not be successful.
China has accused Tibet's exiled spiritual leader, the Dalai Lama, of engineering the protests. There were no reports of any foreigners among the dead, and those that were in Lhasa fled quickly.
Something like 40 trucks with soldiers going in, and 36 tanks, I counted them.
36 tanks.
They went by my hotel, my new hotel. And so it was really, they came down on the Tibetan people really hard.
Now, China faces an even bigger problem as these demonstrations have been matched around the world.
With us to discuss the situation both here and abroad are Nawang Palden from the Tibetan community of New York and New Jersey, as well as a former minister within Tibet's government in exile and the current representative to the Americas for His Holiness the Dalai Lama, Tashi Wangdi. Welcome both of you to the program.
Thank you very much.
March, even without this, is supposed to be a special month for Tibetans. Why is that?
Yeah, it was in 1959 that the Tibetans in Tibet rose against the illegal Chinese occupation in Tibet. So every year on March 10th, Tibetans are organizing these protests to commemorate.
Now this year we're hearing stories of much more vociferous protests, maybe even provoking the authorities with violent protests, but then the crackdowns. And it's very hard to get good information out of Tibet because the restrictions on journalists are so severe. Mm. So we're hearing death tolls anywhere from an official death toll of, I think it's 19, up to reports from activists of 99 people killed. Mm-hmm. What are you hearing? What's the most reliable information that you're getting from inside Tibet about how many people are dying and how?
Actually, you know, the protests initially started as a very nonviolent manner on March 10th. And then when the group of people who were holding a very peaceful demonstration, they were arrested and they were treated very violently. And when people heard about this, then the more people joined in. And then there was a more crackdown. But the death toll, the figure we have is about 99. This is based on almost head count report from various parts of Tibet. It's not only in Lhasa, in central Tibet, so but in other parts of Tibet also. So together, it's, according to our information, is about 99.
So let me assume that the people of Tibet are using the media spotlight because of the Olympics to raise the awareness right at this time. What is it that you want the rest of the world to know?
Yeah, because China has been claiming that they have a very stable country and the human rights inside China and in Tibet are in good condition. We Tibetans think that it's a very important time for us to express to the world that the China, whatever China is politicizing is completely untrue.
That whatever China is politicizing is completely untrue. Well, because you said that, there is a pro-China argument in the Tibet dispute. So here is part of a video making that case. Now, this just went up on YouTube this week and has already gotten 1 million views.
Thank you.
And that's just two of the seven arguments on that video. Let's go down a couple of these things.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The history that Tibet has almost always been a part of China, and that it would be like Indiana saying it no longer wants to be a part of the United States.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the historically it's completely untrue. You know, the argument that Tibet had been part of China since the Yuan dynasty.
When was Tibet independent?
Till 1949.
From when?
From the beginning. We have a recorded history of 2,000 years. And if you read Tibetan history, there's no account of Tibet being part of China at any point. Of course, Chinese emperors, the Mongols, Yuan, the Manchus, they had special relations with Tibet because of Buddhism. And we call it priest-patron relationship.
The Chinese call it what?
Priest-patron relationship.
Priest-patron relationship, yes.
The Chinese emperors considered the Tibetan Buddhist leaders as their priests. And in return for religious connection, blessings, they provided protection to Tibet. But there, if you look at Tibetan history, there's no way that Tibet, no account of Tibetans having paid tax to China.
I've had Chinese.
And the language is totally different. Tibetan language, Tibetan written script is very close to India.
I've had Chinese Americans tell me that really a lot of that is true, and it was really only in the last 100 years before the 1940s that Tibet was its own state in any political sense.
That is completely untrue, because there is no any country with two different currencies. Tibet had their own currencies before the Chinese occupation. It clearly shows that Tibet was politically independent before.
Another argument that I hear is that rather than being oppressed, Tibetans have special employment set aside as an ethnic minority in China, religious rights that many other Chinese don't have, and even an exemption from the one-child law. Is any of that true as far as you're concerned?
No, that is completely untrue. We have ongoing demonstration in Tibet because Tibetans are frustrated over there under the Chinese illegal occupation. Political rights, freedom of speech and religion is considered political crime in Chinese occupied Tibet. So whatever you are saying is completely untrue. Whatever China is claiming, it's completely untrue.
There's a Tibetan mm-hmm. Buddhist temple in the area, in the capital, mm-hmm. where people may worship. And again, some Chinese Americans say to me, look, that's there. Other Chinese in other parts of the country don't have that. And the special employment and no exemption from the one-child law, as far as you're concerned?
Let me put the question the other way around. The recent demonstrations in Tibet, right across Tibet, not only autonomous region of Tibet, but areas which are now the Chinese consider as being part of Sichuan, Gansu, Yunnan, and Qinghai. And Tibetan students studying in Beijing in the universities, handpicked Tibetan students, they have also demonstrated, they've expressed their unhappiness. Now, if everything is as good as they claim, and if there's freedom, if there's special privileges, right, why should they go to this extent? Why should there be this huge uproar of dissatisfaction?
Tell me
and
what's
why
happening.
Don't they allow our challenge to the Chinese authorities and those who claim that everything's all right? Why don't they allow foreign journalists, observers
to go and see?
To go and see. That will be the best test and the judgment.
Tell
of what
me what's happening.
Is.
Locally, there have been some protests locally. How much of a Tibetan community is there here in New York, and how organized?
Yeah, the protest in New York is organized by five major organizations together. So we had like about more than 3,000 Tibetans and supporters here on March 10th. And after that, following the crackdown on the Tibetans by the Chinese in Tibet, we have every day we have protests in front of the Chinese consulate. And every day we have more than thousands of demonstrators.
Mr. Wang Di, you represent the Dalai Lama.
Yes.
Does he advocate more autonomy for Tibet or complete independence?
We have made it absolutely clear to the Chinese government for the last more than 20 years. Both His Holiness has written to the Chinese leaders, have sent messages, have asked foreign leaders to assure the Chinese leaders, including President Bush, that he is not seeking independence.
Then what does autonomy mean?
Autonomy means that Tibetans should have the right to practice their own tradition, their culture, their way of life, and should determine what kind of, you know, the economic life they want to have. At the moment, every decision, all decisions are taken in Beijing for the Tibetan people. And the Tibetans should have the right to decide their own, about their language, their culture, their way of life, within the Chinese constitution. And we believe that Chinese constitution, in theory, provides those possibilities.
Does the coming of the Olympics and world attention to this now increase the possibility that the movement will go all the way toward asking for independence rather than just autonomy?
Actually, among the Tibetans, the will, the political stance differs. It's divided into two. Some are claiming for autonomy, the complete autonomy within the People's Republic of China, and some for independence. But at this point, as a local organizer and a protester, we demand China to immediately act, immediately release all the political prisoners who are imprisoned because of the protests there.
It's bad enough, the crackdown that has taken place already and the deaths that have resulted. Are you worried about something worse, a Tiananmen Square-style crackdown, if you will, between now and the summer?
Yeah, definitely. If it's completely up to the Chinese government to make a proper decision based on the demands put forth by the Tibetans, they have to make a proper decision based on the aspirations of the Tibetan people. Otherwise, Tibetans are really frustrated inside Tibet, and there is a worldwide protest going on against the Chinese occupation.
There will obviously be more discussion, more awareness of this around the world as the Olympics come closer. Thank you two very much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having us.
Coming up in a minute, how long will our economy remain subprime? This is Brian Lehrer Live.
Watch Canapé, the French cultural magazine show, Thursdays on CUNY TV.
Was queen of the mambo, papa was king of the Congo. Deep down in the jungle, I start banging my first bongo. Every monkey like to be in my place instead of me, cause I'm the king of bongo, baby. I'm the king of bongo bong. I went to the big town where there is a lot of sound, from the jungle to the city, looking for a bigger crown. So I play my bongo for the people of big city, but they don't go crazy when I'm banging on my boogie. I'm the
king of the bongo, king of the bongo.
Hear me when I come, baby.
King of the bongo, king of the bongo.
Nobody like to be in my place instead of me, cause nobody go crazy when I'm banging on my boogie. I'm a king without a crown, hanging loose in a big town. But I'm a king of bongo, baby. I'm the king of bongo bong.
Foreclosure doesn't affect just you. It affects your whole family, too. If you've fallen behind on your mortgage, we can help. Call 1-888-995-HOPE, because nothing is worse than doing nothing.
This is Brian Lehrer Live, where web video meets the issues. Looks like Bear Stearns got too full on subprime beef this past week as J.P. Morgan Chase swooped in to gobble up the failing investment house for a paltry $2 a share. With us here to discuss this latest collapse in our very own backyard is Crane's New York Business senior reporter Aaron Elstein. Welcome to the program.
Hello.
So you were telling me just before the cameras rolled that the federal government has never bailed out a major investment bank
this
before.
This is a first. That's right. The only time that the last time we had something like this happen was in 1990 when George Bush's father was president. There was a firm called Drexel Burnham Lambert. You might remember them. And they failed. And the first George Bush administration said, let them go. This time, they bailed out Wall Street. Never happened before.
Subprime mortgages are such a tiny part of the mortgage system in the United States. Most people have the conventional 30-year mortgages and all of that.
That's right.
How did this little corner of the mortgage market wind up threatening the entire banking system?
Well, it was sort of the first pebble of an avalanche. Bear Stearns did a lot of subprime mortgages. They did a lot of other kinds of mortgages, too. And all these mortgages are starting to default at a lot faster rates than anybody ever thought they would. And the reason that Bear collapsed is that Bear is the smallest of these sort of Wall Street banks that deal in these kinds of subprime mortgages. And so they had the least margin for error. And when their losses started to get big, their customers said, I'm out of here. And when you have a run on the bank, you're dead.
And part of the problem, and don't let this make your eyes glaze over, this is actually pretty interesting, it's what they call the securitization of low prime mortgages. In other words, any subprime mortgage is more risky than a regular mortgage.
Mm-hmm.
But securities firms would bundle these together.
Yep.
So it's like buying junk bonds.
That's
right?
Exactly what
high
they were.
Yield, but high risk.
Yep.
And if a lot of those started to go bad as this housing bubble burst, then the people who invested in these whole bundles of subprime mortgages, yeah, which Bear Stearns did in spades, they get brought down.
Yep, yep. There were all these billions of subprime mortgages everywhere. Bear Stearns would go around the country and buy them from banks, from savings and loans, put them into a bond, sell them to institutional investors, and like a hedge fund. And then, you know, as these hedge funds started to blow up because they had invested in so many lousy mortgages, well, now Bear would sort of be on the other side saying, well, you know, our customer just blew up. Now we have these lousy loans. And so, you know, it was like a chain reaction, a daisy chain, basically.
So if the foreclosure man comes to my house, should I tell him that my name is Bear Stearns, so J.P. Morgan will
bail
me out?
Yeah, I got a friend in Treasury who's going to help me out. Yeah, yeah, socialism for Wall Street. That's what we just saw here. Absolutely.
Is it a good thing, in your opinion?
Wow, this is an extraordinary precedent. I don't think people really understand just what happened here and how profound this is. I mean, the government just guaranteed an investment bank. You got to understand the way the Federal Reserve works. It's supposed to provide funding in emergency cases for its member banks. These are banks like Chase, like Citibank. These are not sharks like Wall Street investment banks. They're a very different kind of animal.
So there's a difference here that people should get,
yeah,
between a place like Bear Stearns,
yeah,
right, which was doing all this risky investment, and
yeah,
that's mostly what they did.
Right.
And the more kind of run-of-the-mill investment houses,
what they call
like Citibank.
Deposit institutions, where you and I have put our money. Those places are supposed to get government backing when they hit hard times. It was never thought that a firm like Bear Stearns would be needing the government to help them out, and that's just what they got.
Yeah.
I mean, this deal is extraordinary. The Federal Reserve has been taking $30 billion of these really risky mortgages and guaranteeing them. So if these mortgages default, as they probably will, the Federal Reserve, i.e. the taxpayer, takes the loss.
Now, let's take a look at a video from itulip.com from last year that focused on media coverage of Bear Stearns. Remember, this is from a year ago.
Bear Stearns said problems with risky subprime mortgages were largely contained. The Wall Street firm is the largest American underwriter of securities that are backed by bundled mortgages. Comments from its CFO sparked a rally in the stock. Bear Stearns was largely responsible for the bearish tone. The Wall Street firm is putting up $3.2 billion to bail out a hedge fund damaged by exposure to risky home loans. A second hedge fund was left to work out a plan with creditors. Investors fear there may be more casualties among Wall Street firms. Bear Stearns was down 1.4%.
And you saw that stock price last year up around 150, Bear Stearns finally collapsed to $2 a share this weekend with that buyout. With us by phone now, the creator of that video, Eric Jansen, founder of itulip.com. Thanks a lot for coming on with us, Eric. Hello.
Hey, my pleasure.
So we've had two bubbles now in the last 10 years, tech stocks and then housing.
That's right.
Why does the same thing keep happening?
Well, the whole process got lodged really in the mid-1990s, and the whole problem, again, comes down to the Fed primarily. In the cycle of bailouts and bubbles and fresh bailouts, it just keeps getting bigger and bigger. So the first one was back in the early 1990s. You might remember that there was about 1,000 auto SNLs went out of business between in the late 80s and the early 90s. And what happened is that put the banking system kind of seized up for a while there. It really had a particularly big impact on the real estate industry.
Hey, Eric, let me cut in. Are you on a speakerphone?
No, I'm not.
Okay, you're on a regular handset. We were getting a little audio problem. It sounded like a speakerphone for a minute. Let me ask you about bubbles, since that's your specialty. Since bubbles start with an innovation and end with an investment, aren't they just good old, in the words of economist Joseph Schumpeter, creative destruction? Shouldn't we be looking for even less regulation so the market can innovate?
Well, what you really need in a market is balance. What occurs in bubbles is you can't have bubbles without government involvement. A government is very much involved in creating bubbles. You can have spikes in prices like in gold and so forth, but without government intervention to reinforce them, they never really get that big.
Now, viewers, don't you just wish that just once you were too big to fail and the Fed would bail you out of a financial crisis? Don't get your hopes up, even when the credit cards are stacked against you. Another video from Eric's itulip.com.
I love you, Cash Call. Cash wired right into my account. No one else would lend me money, not even my relatives. Cash Call, you're awesome. If you need to borrow cash for any reason, call 877-860-CASH.
Wow, Eric, did I see that right? A 99% interest rate?
Yeah, that's our discount window.
Tell us what the message of that video really is.
Well, the message of the video is that if you're a investment bank and you've made some really bad decisions and you're in trouble, you're going to get the Fed offering loans to you at very very accommodating rates so that you can survive and move on. But if you're just your average homeowner and you make some mistakes, your only opportunity when your credit rating is trash is to go borrow at 99%.
So what would you like to see the government do for the individual homeowner?
Well, I think what's missing here, and I think what's really upsetting people about the Fed's move, is the concept of fairness really seems to have been lost here. And it doesn't seem fair to have a system that allows a certain class of speculators to not have to suffer the consequences of their decisions and have other groups of people who do have to suffer the full consequences. So it's creative destruction for your average wage earner, but not for a certain class of banking.
But if the government bailed out everybody who invests in a mortgage or takes out a mortgage on a home that they can't ultimately afford, that creates what the Treasury Secretary Henry Paulson the other day called a moral hazard. In other words, it sets a precedent where other people and other decisions in their lives or their businesses will start taking undue risks, feeling, well, if this gets too bad, the government's going to bail me out. Taxpayers are going to do it.
Well, the evidence is that that's not how average people think. The way what really happened here is that we had a situation where the banking system invented a bunch of creative products
and these really are loan products, and they sold them on the pretense that they were safe to investors, and they separated the guys selling them, making the commission selling the products, had no accountability for whether the loans worked or not. And so what happened was all these guys are out there selling these loans and taking off with the money, and the people that are taking these loans out are told that these are safe. And it is really very much the tendency of most people when they're sitting in front of somebody who is representing themselves as representing a bank to assume that a bank is not going to lend you money if they don't think you deserve it or you can pay it back.
Let me bring Aaron Elstein from Cranes New York Business back into the conversation. How is this affecting the New York area? Real estate is so famously expensive in New York. Listener to my radio show this morning, posting under the name Middle Class, wrote, "Does this mean we get our neighborhoods back?"
Boy, wouldn't that be nice. I can tell you that one of the impacts is going to be there are about 5,000 or 6,000 employees at Bear Stearns that are going to lose their jobs really soon, and that's going to take a little bit of a bite out of the housing market. But, you know, it's the failure of one institution, or the rescue of one, is not going to really.
It's not just Bear Stearns. I understand that 30,000 jobs have been lost on Wall Street, and then beyond that, housing prices are going down nationwide because they were in a bubble.
They were inflated. You bet.
And locally?
Locally, you know, I would think they would come down rather significantly here. I don't see why New York is that different from anywhere else.
We may be different because we have a chronic 60-year-plus housing shortage relative to demand.
Yeah.
I don't know that that's going to even it out.
I've heard that theory. And I've also heard there's less building done here and less speculative building. And these things are true, but tastes change. Real estate reminded me a lot of the stock market in the late 90s. Remember when the tech stock bubble was going on? You had to be in the stock market because you had to be in it. You had to be in real estate because you had to be in it 3 or 4 years ago. Tastes change. And people who rent it are looking really good right now.
So, Eric Jansen, part of this pattern has been that Alan Greenspan lowered interest rates a number of times over his career at the Fed to get us out of previous recessions. One of those times when interest rates got so low, that helped people borrow a lot of money to invest in tech stocks, and that became an inflated bubble and crashed. Then interest rates got lowered again after 9/11 and after the WorldCom and Enron scandals and all of that, that recession. And that resulted in a lot of money moving out of stocks and other kinds of investments into housing. And that became a bubble and crash. So now we're in another recession, more or less, and the interest rates are coming down, down, down. We saw the Fed cut another 0.75 yesterday, practically unprecedented. And I wonder, is this going to inspire some other bubble?
Well, let's look at what happened. We just had this major rate cut, 0.75, stock market rallied about 400 points. Then today, the market took back about 0.75 of that. So we had a one-day rally on one of the largest rate cuts in history on top of other seriously large rate cuts recently. And what this is saying, what the market is saying is that it's voting that these measures are not likely to work very well this time. And the reason is that last time when the Fed lowered rates to create the housing bubble, the dollar was strong, our budget was in surplus, taxes had not been reduced yet. And all those bullets have been spent. So here we are running large deficits. We already have relatively low interest rates. We have high inflation, as anyone can observe who eats or buys gasoline. And yet the only tool that the government has left to try to reflate the economy is to cut interest rates and to flood the system with money.
Well,
it's not a very good situation for us to be in.
Is it the only tool, Aaron? Because I've heard people complain that the government is not using other tools that it has, maybe even actually buying up some of this outstanding mortgage debt directly.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is the best blunt tool they have is to cut interest rates. But, You know, they're running out of bullets here. They're what, 2% now?
Yeah, about.
Yeah, you can't go much lower.
Well, that's the interest rate that the government sets. Mm-hmm. But one thing I think I see out there is that that's considered a short-term interest rate, right?
Right.
The long-term interest rates in people's real lives,
like
for actual home mortgages and for student loans.
Those are going up.
Yeah, why is that?
Well, what's happening is that the Bernanke was asked by Congress about a month ago, what do we do about this recession that's coming up here? And one of the congressmen was unusually astute. They're not usually very sharp on this topic, but asked, we have a lot of inflation, and we also have this recession. What can you do? And Bernanke's response was, you're right, I have two problems, and I have one tool. So the answer. So what he's basically saying is that everything that the government can do under the current circumstances to stimulate the economy is going to produce more inflation. And I think that's what most people, I think, are not really understanding about the conundrum that we're in right now.
All right. Thanks a lot for joining us. We really appreciate it. From itulip.com, some good videos and some interesting information. And, Aaron, we've got about 2 minutes left. This bailout and buyout of Bear Stearns, it was done not even so much to help Bear Stearns, really, as to make sure that there wasn't a collapse in confidence in the entire banking system. Then money wouldn't be worth the paper it was printed on because nobody would trust its value.
Right.
Did it work?
Well, the market hasn't completely collapsed since the Bear Stearns announcement came out, so I guess in that sense it's kind of worked. I mean, the problem here is the precedent the government just set. This will happen again, and when it does, is the government going to be on the hook for an even bigger bank failure? I would think they would be, since they just bailed out Bear Stearns.
Well, maybe that's a good thing, that the banking system is not seen as any other corporate sector, because the entire rest of the economy runs on, in effect, the federal government's willingness to underwrite the banking system.
Wall Streeters get paid an awful lot of money to take big risks, and there should be big punishments when those risks don't work, right? I find what just happened here to be really dubious, to say the least. Now, if you work at Bear Stearns and you had a stock that was worth $170 a year ago, now it's worth $2, you're not feeling like you got rewarded.
Right.
You're feeling punished. But the fact is that the firm did get bailed out. The firm did not go bankrupt. If this firm had gone bankrupt, it would have been worth a lot less than $2. I just find what happened here to be astonishing.
Obviously not the end of the story. Aaron Elstein from Crane's New York Business, thank you very much.
Thank you.
And that is it for tonight's show. We're here live Wednesday nights at 7:30, and we're available as a podcast. You can sign up at CUNY.TV. Next week, the history of political cartoons will show you how much racial paranoia exists in that history. And don't forget my daily radio show, 10 o'clock every morning on WNYC Radio. Tomorrow, the former Israeli Defense Minister Shlomo Ben Ami, who says negotiate with Hamas. That's on 93.9 FM, AM 820, and WNYC.org. Have a great night.